good afternoon. Just under 20 minutes to go in today's football matches. The Vidi printer is running. There's plenty of time for scorelines to change and for precious points to be won or lost. Martin Keown, Lee Dixon and Garth Crooks are here to comment on today's Barclays Premier League matches. One already over, Liverpool 2, Manchester United 1, the final score. Two other results already in, Motherwell 2, Celtic 4, and in League 1, it finished Leicester 0, Millwall 1. But let's hear about matches still being played. The details first on the Newcastle Hull game. News that talks had taken place to try and persuade Kevin Keegan to return as manager only intensified the atmosphere at St James's Park. It's been a busy day for Damian Johnson and it's not over.
Yes, Newcastle trail by 2-0. Two goals from striker Marlon King have added to Newcastle's woes. Pre-match demonstrations against the owner Mike Ashley and banners in the crowd. These are troubled times after Kevin Keegan's departure. City have been good value though. King dispatched a first half penalty and raced clear to score with a well-taken finish in the second. After getting behind their team after kickoff today, I've never known St James's Park so subdued. Newcastle in trouble. Hull City lead 2-0.
Newcastle season at present in disarray on the pitch and off the pitch. Gianfranco Zola officially takes charge of the West Ham team on Monday. He's watching the Hammers away at West Bromwich Albion. Albion 1 from 9, West Ham 6 from 9 going into this game. Ivan Gaskell reporting.
Tremendous fun, 2-2, open, high pace, high entertainment. We even saw Adrian Childs introduced to the crowd at half-time. It doesn't get better than that. James Morrison set the tone in 2 minutes. Noble and Neil improved the spirits of new boss Zola, but Bednar levelled it again from the penalty spot in a brilliant first half. All we need is a stand-up routine from Frank Skinner at the end and my day is complete. 2-2.
Burnley looking for their first win this season. They might get it. They've just taken the lead away at Nottingham Forest. Graham Alexander with a penalty on 70 minutes. 1-1, drawn 1, lost 1 for Blackburn, 4 out of 9, 6 out of 9 for Arsenal, going into the game that Andrew James is watching at Ewood Park.
Yes, Blackburn 0, Arsenal 2, Ray, and if this is a job application from Paul Ince for anything at Newcastle, it's not going too well. They've been completely outclassed. Van Persie's third goal of the season in first half was made for him by Theo Walcott, who started but has now been substituted. Adebayor's first goal of the season just before half-time was pure class at the end of a 30-passing move from Arsenal. They could have scored since then. Rovers haven't looked like scoring. It's 2-0 to the Arsenal.
1-1, lost 4 for Crewe so far this season. Looks like they're going to get points at home to Colchester. Bradford, 4 wins out of 5 in League 2, are going to make it 5 out of 6. They're beating Exeter by 4-1. And Hearts have equalised away at Falkirk in the SPL. Michael Stewart on 71 minutes. Having 1-1 and lost 2, important Portsmouth win or at least avoid defeat at home to Middlesbrough. Other way round for Borough, 1-2, lost 1. Mark Bishop reporting.
Portsmouth 1, Middlesbrough 1. A spirited fight back from Portsmouth after Meadows' opener threatened to open the floodgates for the visitors. Redknapp stuck on Utaka and Nadir Belhaj for his debut for the start of the second half. And what a difference it's made. Defoe slotting home after a great flick on by Crouch, even though Meadow was down injured. That will be the game's talking point this evening. And we've just seen a great clearance by Rigott off the line after Defoe had beaten Turnbull. One apiece at Fratton Park.
At Craven Cottage on the banks of the River Thames, Fulham are playing Bolton. Both clubs feel it's a game they should take at least a point away from. Andy May reporting.
They're two up and Fulham have completely dominated here at Craven Cottage. Their record signing Andy Johnson's kept Bolton's defence busy, but it's his strike partner Bobby Zamora whose name's on the score sheet. A lovely clean strike just inside the Bolton box in the first half, coming after a similar low drive from left winger Zoltan Gera. He's just had a header against the bar as well. They beat Arsenal 3 weeks ago. Looking at Fulham this afternoon, Roy Hodgson's men shouldn't be too worried about relegation this season. Bolton definitely should. They've been very poor. Fulham 2, Bolton 0.
Wigan and Sunderland have both lost 2 of their 3 Premier League matches played ahead of the game being going on at the JJB Stadium. Third defeat would signal a poor start of this season for either club. Steve Sutton reporting.
Finally balanced, Ray. Wigan 0, Sunderland 1, the only goal of the game so far. A Titus Bramble own goal on 15 minutes of the first half. Sunderland nearly stole a second against the run of play on the hour. Cisse through, his shot saved by the feet of Chris Kirkland. But then a few moments later, Amezaki, Wigan's top scorer, saw his header shave the outside of the post with Craig Gordon well beaten. 0-1 at the moment.
Still time for scorelines to change. More details now on the Liverpool-Manchester United match that finished just on 2 hours ago. Guy Mowbray was at Anfield.
A Liverpool Premier League victory over Manchester United for the first time in 9 attempts and the first under Rafa Benitez. It didn't start that way. United in front after 2.5 minutes. Dimitar Berbatov on his debut pulling the ball back for Carlos Tevez to finish emphatically. But Liverpool, even with Gerrard and Torres only on the bench, fought back brilliantly. They were level before half-time when Van der Sar palmed the ball against a hapless Wes Brown for an own goal. And then they came at United right from the off after the break to get their reward after 76 minutes. Tenacity shown by Mascherano to keep the ball in, vision from Count to pick out substitute Ryan Babel, and a shot that bounced into the deck and into the net in front of the Kop. Worse for United, Vidic sent off before full-time for two yellow card offences, both of which might have merited a straight red. Liverpool 2, Manchester United 1.
A significant victory for Liverpool to the JJB Stadium. A goal in the Wigan-Sunderland game. Steve Sutton reporting.
Yes, Ray, it's gone to Wigan. It's Wigan 1, Sunderland 1. And it's that man, Amezaki, who's scored it for Wigan on 77. It was a lightning attack from Wigan. They've been doing that all the second half. The ball fell to Zaki in the penalty area and he swept it into the net from close range. 1-1, now game on.
Scunthorpe 2, Carlisle 1. Danny Carlton on 77 minutes. Can Carlisle save a point in that game? What was the turning point in the Liverpool-Manchester United match? This was, by the way, a significant victory for Liverpool.
It was. Turning point, probably the own goal, Wes Brown. We disagree on this, Lee and I. I just thought that it's just, you know, if a goalkeeper's got to save, make a save twice to stop the ball from going in, it's really, really unfortunate. He makes a good save, but it hits Brown and goes into the back of the net.
I don't think it necessarily was a turning point in the game. I think Liverpool overall were the best side, and certainly second half they played the better football. And United were a little bit, you know, after their great start, United were a bit under par. And on the day, Liverpool played better and they scored the goals and got the deserved win.
Pre-match protests at St James's Park over the management structure that saw Kevin Keegan resign. Newcastle fans clearly have no time for Mike Ashley and Dennis Wise and other members of the management structure. They're voicing their concerns and the team are losing at home.
Well, it does affect the players. You know, they've got to go out and perform and they're not doing. They've played poorly today. And don't take anything away from Hull because they've jumped on the bandwagon here and Phil Brown has got his players fired up. They've scored two goals away from home and after the drubbing they had against Wigan, they bounced back really well, Hull. So well done to them. But there's turmoil at St James's Park.
I can't help feeling they've taken advantage of a bad situation there, Hull. Yeah. Newcastle should not be in this situation.
Not sure this is healable as far as Newcastle fans are concerned for the management structure. What will Gianfranco Zola have learned so far from the West Ham team that he's watching?
Well, it was quite a difficult start for him. His team went down. He came back into the match, went 2-1 in front, and it's now 2-2. And, you know, it's difficult for West Ham because West Brom have played at a real high tempo. It's a real blood and thunder match, this one.
Still time for someone to get a winner in that game. Let's go back to Ewood Park. Developments, Andrew James.
Yes, yeah, a possible third goal for Arsenal on the cards here, Ray. That's because there's a penalty, but there may be a delay before it's taken. So I'll just very quickly fill you in on what's happened. Stephen Warnock, the Blackburn left-back, has adjudged to have brought down Emmanuel Aboué. Aboué is getting some lengthy treatment, but the Blackburn fans feel that Aboué has made a complete meal of it. The linesman didn't give the penalty. He was closest, the assistant referee. It was Mike Dean, the referee, who gave the decision of his own account. It'll be Adebayor who will take it, but we're still a good few seconds away from it being taken, Ray, so I'll leave it with you. But it's still at the moment Blackburn 0, Arsenal 2.
Well, we wait for that penalty to be taken. Let's go to the Charlton Wolves game. Tony Lockwood of the Valley.
And the Wolves' comeback could be complete. The league leaders are in front by 2-1. Sam Vokes, a Wolves substitute, close range, strong and decisive with a beautiful finish wide of Weaver. This after Sylvain Ebanks-Blake had levelled it up from the penalty spot after Nicky Bailey's stunning strike from Charlton early on. We've been playing Eddie 1, it's Charlton 1, the league leaders Wolves 2.
Let's immediately go back to St James's Park. Developments, Damian Johnson.
Yes, Newcastle have pulled a goal back. Sisco, the Spanish striker, has followed up after Zogbia hit the post. Hull City 2-1 up now.
And let's go back to Ewood Park and if Andrew James, penalty about to be taken.
Adebayor comes up to take the penalty against Paul Robinson, the ex-Tottenham goalkeeper, and beats him in front of a huge following of Arsenal fans. Adebayor's second goal of the game, his second goal for Arsenal of the season, Ray, and it's Blackburn 0, Arsenal 3, and all over, surely.
Arsenal very impressive this afternoon. You felt the second goal was one of the best goals you've ever seen.
Well, we've seen it a couple of times on replay and we actually keep rewinding it to go back to when the move started, and we've got to about 5 minutes and we still haven't got to the start of it because he was literally, I think it was about 30 passes. So great, great goal.
Are Newcastle going to salvage something in this game now? It's tailor-made for them now to provide a grandstand finish and at least grab a point from this game.
Well, it might get something out of what's been a very bad week for them and particularly bad day. So the atmosphere there today has been terrible, really, and just shows you they need to get the fans on board and everyone pulling in the right direction. An opportunity here. I mean, it might be a bit harsh on Hull because they've been decent today.
Yeovil have lost the last four. That equaliser might get them a point at home to Brighton. Chester might get 3 points this afternoon away at Grimsby. Grimsby looking for their first win of the season. Newcastle 1, Hull 2, just confirming the score at St James's Park, and also that Arsenal have taken a 3-0 lead away at Ewood Park. Let's go back to the Hawthorns. West Bromwich Albion against West Ham. Ivan Gaskell.
And a goal to fit a really riveting occasion here at the Hawthorns. West Brom 3, West Ham 2. Chris Brunt has scored the goal, a move that went from one end to the other. It's really the way the game has panned out too. It was an excellent move from one end, as I say, to the other. Paul Robinson's pass into Brunt was excellent. He managed to compose himself. He switched the ball into the other corner. Green was beaten, and it looks as if West Ham are two. West Brom 3, West Ham 2.
Well, this could be highly significant for West Bromwich Albion. 1 point out of nine being tested, and looks like they've come up with the answer.
It's a really good game, Ray. It's been end-to-end, and it's sort of sad that someone's had to lose a game, because from an entertainment point of view, it's been great, hasn't it, Garth?
It's been a fantastic game. I rather suspect that West Ham will be really, really disappointed, because when they started to really take control of this game, and to be 3-2 down with Franco Zola in the side, making an assessment of who's going to be playing next week, it's quite tough on that team.
Still time for scorelines to change. Goals can change the results of the matches. To Scotland, though, let's hear details of a match already over. The Motherwell Celtic game. Here's Roddy Forsyth.
Motherwell didn't realise this game had started. Celtic thought it was all over. That would be the simplest summary of this intriguing contest between Scotland's two European contenders. Not that you'd have supposed Motherwell had many ambitions in that direction, to judge by the state of them in the first half. Two goals down in 8 minutes to Maloney and Samaras, that were baffled by Celtic's pace and hunger in a 45 minutes that produced two more goals, one from McDonald and another from Samaras, not to mention a Maloney free kick that slapped off the crossbar. The restart brought a transformation. Two goals in 3 minutes, this time for Motherwell. Motherwell with strikes from Sutton and Clarkson, but their improbable comeback stalled amidst a flurry of bookings which were rather less compelling than what had gone before.
Well, Celtic kicked off 3 points behind the top two. That was Rangers and Kilmarnock, both unbeaten. Two teams playing each other at Ibrox, watched by Brian McLaughlin.
It's Rangers 2, Kilmarnock 1. A double from Chris Boyd in 57 and 61 minutes, putting Rangers in front after Fraser Wright had given Kilmarnock the lead in the first half. Killy, though, almost back in level terms. Gary Hayes' shot cleared off the line by Sasa Papic. And the rebound from Danny Invincible also cleared away by the Czech defender. 6 minutes left here at Ibrox. Great game. Rangers 2, Killy 1.
Well, let's go back to Craven Cottage. Andy Mays following the Fulham-Bolton game for us.
Bolton have pulled one back. They trail now by 2-1. And the whole of Craven Cottage just fell silent because it looked like Heider Helgeson, who just touched the ball in from about a couple of yards out, was actually offside when he moved onto the ball and then put it into the back of the net. But Bolton won't be moaning, nor their fans. There's not many of them, though. Craven Cottage, Fulham 2, Bolton 1.
Fulham will kick themselves if they let any points go missing here. To the JJB Stadium, Wigan against Sunderland, Steve Sutton.
Well, we haven't had a goal, Ray, but we've had a red card, two yellows, in fact, for Wigan's Lee Catamole. Nasty-looking challenge on Tanyo in the centre circle area. No need for it, really. And it's a second yellow. Lee Catamole off, Wigan down to 10 men. It's 1-1.
To the Championship news on the Coventry-Preston match. Preston unbeaten, 3 wins and a draw, 1-2, lost 2 for Coventry. Steve Lee reporting.
Yes, it's still Coventry nil, Preston nil, and as a Warwickshire writer brought up not too far from here would have it, much ado about nothing. We've had a whole host of chances, Meller in particular for Preston with a wonderful volley at the start of the second half, Sean St. Ledger with a good header too, and at the other end, Doyle and Morrison both missing good chances, but it seems destined to be goalless. We've only got to 7 minutes remaining, it's 0-0.
After four games played, Blackpool and Barnsley both kicked off in the bottom half of the table. Alan Biggs reporting.
Blackpool looking for their first home point of the season. It looks like they're going to get all three. They lead Barnsley by a goal to nil. Stephen Cabba with the effort. It was worth the wait. A blazing drive from 25 yards. Barnsley have only held out through goal line clearances from Steve Foster and Kozlok from Southern and Nardiello. Very strong finish by Blackpool. They lead by a goal to nil.
Top of the table, Wolves had taken their unbeaten record to the Valley to play Charlton, who'd won two, lost two going into the game. Tony Lockwood reporting.
It's a Wolves triumph. Charlton 1, Wolves 3, less than 3 minutes remaining. Sam Vokes with his second of the match. Flowing football, stooping header to conquer. Vokes scores 2, Wolves scores 3, and they are going to stay top of the division. Charlton 1, Wolves 3.
Wolves top of the table and scoring goals. 10 points from 12 for unbeaten Birmingham ahead of the home game with promoted Doncaster. Ian Winter reporting.
Ray, it's Birmingham City 1, Doncaster 0. Birmingham caught the Doncaster defence half asleep just 44 seconds into the second half. Cameron Jerome's close-range volley looks to be enough to keep them close with Wolves on top of the Championship tonight. And that after playing most of the game with only 10 men after Nafti was sent off in the first half for a late two-footer tackle. Birmingham 1, Doncaster 0.
And Birmingham and Wolves setting the pace in the Championship. To St James's Park, Newcastle against Hull. Can Newcastle save the situation, Damian Johnson?
It remains Newcastle 1, Hull City 2. Hull City being forced to hang on here after playing pretty well and controlling most of the game. That Sisco goal following up from Nzogbia's shot, which hit the post, has given them hope. The crowd are really behind them for the first time in the game, really. Hull City hanging on, but they still lead by 2-1.
High scorers Dagenham and Redbridge in League 2 have two more at home to Chesterfield. Dagenham and Redbridge 2, Chesterfield 0. Hearing news of a goal at Fratton Park. Portsmouth playing Middlesbrough this afternoon. Let's hear from Mark Bishop.
Yes, Ray, as you join me, it's Portsmouth 2, Middlesbrough 1. The fight back is complete. Who else but Jermaine Defoe crashing the ball past Turnbull. Terrific fight back from Portsmouth. They are trailed 1-0 to that Mido goal in the first half. And then the equaliser from Pompey. And now they lead by 2-1.
They had a tough start to the season, didn't they? Portsmouth, Chelsea, Manchester United, then they beat Everton. This will be a great comeback. Did you see the goal clearly, Garth?
Yeah, tremendous volley. The ball comes straight back into the box, around the penalty spot area, and Defoe just swivels and takes the ball mid-air and buries the goal. They've come back from 1-0 down, and there's no turning point in this game, but in the Liverpool United game, I'm convinced there was, because I think United were in control up until that point, the own goal.
Let's hear about the Ipswich-Reading game. With 3 points out of 12 and having lost both home games, Ipswich really want to get something this afternoon from this game. Robin Bailey reporting.
Portman Road is bouncing again because John Walters has just put them 2-0 up in the 85th minute, and that is that against Reading. Reading won't come back from this. A fantastic debut day it's been for Jonathan Stead, signed on deadline day from Sheffield United. A wonderful left-footed goal which broke the deadlock 18 minutes into the second half. And Walters has just converted an Alan Quinn cross. 2-0 Ipswich.
100% at home for Shrewsbury Town so far this season. And 7 goals this afternoon at the expense of Gillingham. Ben Davis with the magnificent 7th. Shrewsbury 7, Gillingham 0. Final whistle starting to go in Scotland. Still time for goals to change the destination of the points in the English matches being played this afternoon. Let's go to Selhurst Park. Are Crystal Palace going to get their first win of the season at the expense of promoted Swansea? Neil Henderson reporting.
Looks like it, Ray, the Eagles versus the Swans today, but Palace certainly flying in this one. Ben Watson netting in the first half. In the second, it was a Nick Carl 25-yard drive, his third of the season, and taking him on the way to their first league win in 5 games. Swansea had a chance to move into the top 4, but Neil Warnock's side have had more dig. 2-0.
A final whistle starting to sound all over the country, in Scotland, in England, in Wales, and the matches being played in Ireland too. Let's hear about the League One match between unbeaten Oldham. They're playing MK Dons, who started the season well after being promoted as League Two champions. Mark Clement reporting.
It's Oldham 1, MK Dons. Now Lee Hughes on 8 minutes. Should be 2, but for Willie Gerry's brilliant point-blank save from Lewis Alessandro's volley from inside the 6-yard box. Hard graft from the leaders today, but they're deservedly hanging on at the moment. It's Oldham 1, MK Dons 0.
Barnet have lost every game so far this season. Well, they haven't. They've drawn one now. Barnet 1, Morecambe 1 in League 2. First point of the season for Barnet. To Ibrox, Brian McLaughlin following the Rangers-Kilmarnock game.
Still Rangers 2, Kilmarnock 1, but Rangers playing out time with just 10 men. Sasa Papic's second yellow card in the afternoon. A ruthless tackle on substitute Donovan Campsey. They're now deep into stoppage time. Rangers 2, Kilmarnock 1.
Wigan Sunderland, still time for a goal to change things round here. Steve Sutton.
Yes, and Wigan are trying desperately to get it, Ray. It's Wigan 1, Sunderland 1. We're 2 minutes into added on time. Wigan are on the attack. Zaki got the equaliser for Wigan after Titus Bramble had put through his own goal in the first half. And that gave Sunderland the lead. Wigan have a throw-in deep in the Sunderland half. It's been pretty much all one-way traffic this half. Time running out, it's still 1-1.
Time running out for Bolton. Can they save the game? Andy Mays at Craven Cottage.
It doesn't look likely after that goal from Helgeson just a few moments ago. 30 seconds or so left. Fulham still dominating. They've just taken off Bobby Zamora, though. Eric Nevlin's come on, and Andy Johnson's also off as well on his debut for the home side. Fulham 2, Bolton 1.
Leicester played and won at lunchtime, still unbeaten in League 1. Scunthorpe 5th, Carlisle 2nd. Ben Jacobs reporting.
Scunthorpe 2, Carlisle 1, and despite Danny Carlton's close-range finish, it seems like a first-league defeat for Carlisle. Paul Hayes looks to have given Scunthorpe a fourth straight victory, tapping in after Ben Williams parried Martin Wolford's stinging shot from 20 yards. Sub Matt Sparrow also scored with a header, though defender Danny Livesey was ball, or should I say bird-watching. Scunthorpe 2, Carlisle 1.
Falkirk 2, Hearts 1 in the SPL. Goal at Ewood Park, Andrew James reporting on the Blackburn-Arsenal match.
Well, they may have temporarily fallen out of love with Adebayor, those Arsenal fans, but they quite like him now, Ray. He's scored a hat-trick. It's a third goal for Adebayor, a fourth goal for Arsenal. And, well, if Newcastle do want Paul Ince as their manager, they must have seen something the Rovers fans haven't in successive defeats now by 4 goals. It's Blackburn 0, Arsenal 4.
Let's hear about Falkirk against Hearts. Bad start of the season for Falkirk. They're going to turn it round, I think, Ian Turner.
Yes, indeed. It's not been a great football match, but it's been... ball itself hasn't been fantastic, but Scott Arfield has snatched it for Falkirk right at the death. The 89 from 18 yards. They're hanging on now. Hearts on the attack, but it's Falkirk 2, Hearts 1.
Woking still searching for their first win in the Blue Square. They're going to get it this afternoon at the expense of Grays Athletic. Rangers have won in the SPL. They're top of the table. They beat Kilmarnock by 2-1. Kilmarnock's unbeaten record comes to an end. Full time at the JJB Stadium, Wigan against Sunderland. Steve Sutton reporting.
It's finished Wigan 1, Sunderland 1, Ray. Depending on which side you're following, for Wigan, probably a frustrating afternoon. Steve Bruce will think he should have had all 3 points. But Roy Keane, well, that was the battling sort of performance he wants to see from a Sunderland side. Briefly, the story of the match. Titus Bramble with a header through his own goal on 15 minutes gave Sunderland an unlikely lead. Then in the second half, Wigan pushed and pushed. It was pretty much all one-way traffic, but Sunderland very nearly sneaked a second when Cisse was through and Chris Kirkland saved with his feet. Then on 69 minutes, Amir Zaki's header shaved the outside of the post, very nearly the equaliser, but a few minutes later, he made certain from around the penalty spot area, swept the ball into the net. Lee Catamol for Wigan sent off after a second yellow on 85, but Sunderland couldn't capitalise on 10-man Wigan and he's finished 1-1.
They'll be happy with the point. Let's go to Ewood Park. Arsenal, well, they looked really impressive this afternoon by all accounts. 4 goals, Theo Walcott started, then he came off. One of the goals that Adebayor scored was being classed as one of the best goals ever by the guys in the studio here. Let's hear from Andrew James on a convincing Arsenal victory.
Yes, Ray, it was a display of pure class from Arsenal, who won without reaching top gear, but still managed some exquisite moments, as you say, like Walcott's pass to Van Persie for the first goal, or the impressive 30-pass move that led to that second, a header by Adebayor, his first of the season. Adebayor then got a second from a penalty after Warnock brought down Eboué. Eboué a doubt for Champions League duty in Kiev now, after being stretched away. Adebayor's hat-trick came with a solo effort in stoppage time. Blackburn were poor, and if Newcastle really do want him to manage them, they must really have seen something that the fans haven't at Blackburn Rovers. That's 2 successive 4-goal defeats.
Yeah, still playing at St James's Park, but let's go back to Damian Johnson, Newcastle against Hull.
Yeah, Newcastle down to 10 men. Danny Guthrie sent off for a stupid lunge at Craig Fagan in the far corner.
It had to be a red card, and Andre Mariner, the referee, had no doubts. He sent him straight off. Newcastle still trailing by 2-1. Hull City hanging on at points in this game late on. They're still hanging on. We're in injury time. They lead 2-1.
That's sending off more than deserved, I understand. And Newcastle just on the pitch and off the pitch. Are things out of control?
Danny Guthrie didn't just have one whack at this lad. He had two. It was a disgraceful display of indiscipline and just rank bad behaviour.
Let's go to the Hawthorns. Ivan Gaskell watched the West Bromwich Albion West Ham match. First win of the season for the Baggies.
Yes, deserved too. West Brom winners by the odd goal in five here. A real advert for the Premier League from first or rather second minute when James Morrison opened the scoring to last breathless end-to-end entertainment. West Ham fully participating, indeed, through Noble and Neil actually taking the lead before Bednar squared it from the spot, all before the half-time whistle. A hatful of chances, both keepers fully stretched, the fans fully satisfied. West Brom's just that little bit more by the end, though, when Chris Brunt completed a counter-attack late on. West Brom wrapping up a pulsating first win over West Ham here in 23 years, sitting watching in the stands, Gianfranco Zola, come on down. West Brom 3, West Ham 2.
Studio Gianfranco Zola watching his team in defeat. A terrific win for Hull City this afternoon, having been beaten 5-0 at home to Wigan. They've won at St James's Park. The protests before the game from the Newcastle fans will get louder and louder. Newcastle United are a club in disarray at the moment, on the pitch and off the pitch, it appears. Damian Johnson.
Yes, Hull City 2-1 winners here. Another low at the end of 2 weeks that have seen Newcastle United in turmoil. The day began badly enough with pre-match demonstrations against the owner, Mike Ashley. Marlon King's first half penalty put City ahead and severely dented Newcastle fans' attempts to get behind their team. King doubled the Tigers' lead in the second half, racing clear in acres of space to finish in style. Confidence visibly ebbed from the home side. City could have had a third. Michael Turner's header was disallowed. Sisko followed up to score after Nzobia's shot hit the post to give Newcastle hope. And late on, Danny Guthrie was sent off for a foolish kick at Craig Fagan. And whatever next for Newcastle.
An away win for Tranmere Rovers at Huddersfield, just going off the bottom of the Vidi printer. A victory for Fulham this afternoon. Andy May reporting.
Fulham were all over Bolton, and to be honest with you, deserve to win by more than just a goal. Andy Johnston, Zoltan Gira and Bobby Zamora running rings around Roy Hedgson, the shaky Bolton defence. Record signing Johnson failed to grab a goal on his Fulham debut, but both Gira and Zamora did, both with low driven good finishes just inside the Bolton box. The away side's goal came from Helgerson, who tapped in from close range, but Gary Megson's side were poor, and Fulham, who beat Arsenal 3 weeks ago, should be in for a season that doesn't involve scrap for their Premier League lives. Fulham 2, Bolton 1.
Escape to victory players at Craven Cottage, and it's a victory for Fulham this afternoon. Oldham still unbeaten in League One, beat the MK Dons. Let's go to Fratton Park, Portsmouth against Middlesbrough. Mark Bishop.
Portsmouth 2, Middlesbrough 1. Jermaine Defoe showing his international pedigree with a terrific volley to complete a great fight back from Harry Redknapp's side. How difficult it had been in the first half for Portsmouth. Borough dominated, Amido had coolly taken his chance from close range. It looked ominous for the home side. Then controversy in the second half surrounding Portsmouth's equaliser. Defoe crashed the ball past Turnbull after referee Stuart Atwell didn't stop play with Mido down injured. Defoe should have had his hat-trick right at the death. O'Neill cleared his tame effort off the line, but it didn't matter. Back-to-back victories now for Portsmouth. 2-1, they've beaten Middlesbrough.
First home win of the season for Darlington. Hull City, fourth in the table in a Champions League spot as things stand. Crewe 2, Colchester 0. Let's hear about the Charlton Wolves game. Wolves kicked off unbeaten, top of the table. Tony Lockwood reporting.
And they stay unbeaten and they stay top of the Championship. This after a stunning strike from Nicky Bailey had rocked them back on their heels in the opening minutes. A penalty on the hour mark, just reward for a stylish away display. Sylvain Ebanks-Blake drove home the resulting spot kick, and then substitute Sam Vokes came off the bench to apply the finishing touches. First a close range finish and then a stooping header to make sure of all 3 points. Charlton 1, Wolves 3.
Birmingham kicked off and beaten at home to Doncaster. Ian Winter reporting.
Rates finished Birmingham City 1, Doncaster Rovers 0. Relegated 4 months ago, Birmingham have now taken 13 points from their first 5 games of the Championship. Cameron Jerome's volley settled this one very early in the second half. Doncaster will feel they deserved a draw after the Blues had Nafti sent off midway through the first half. But Birmingham had enough experience to secure another vital victory. 1-0 here at St Andrews.
English football's most expensive player is on the pitch at the City of Manchester Stadium. Brazilian striker Rubinho, warming up out of Manchester City's game with Chelsea. Rubinho bought for £32 million as a direct result of City being bought by the Abu Dhabi-based company, reportedly worth £560 billion. Just to put that in context, it said Chelsea owner Roman Abramovich is worth just under £12 billion. Rubinho plays for Manchester City in the 5:30 kickoff, Manchester City against Chelsea. You can hear commentary on that match on Radio 5 Live. Well, all today's results are just about in. Time for Tim Gudgeon to confirm today's final scores.
In the Barclays Premier League, Blackburn Rovers 0, Arsenal 4. Fulham 2, Bolton Wanderers 1. Liverpool 2, Manchester United 1. Manchester City and Chelsea kick off in about a quarter of an hour. Newcastle United 1, Hull City 2. Portsmouth 2, Middlesbrough 1. West Bromwich Albion 3, West Ham United 2. Wigan Athletic 1, Sunderland 1. In the Coca-Cola Championship, Birmingham City 1, Doncaster Rovers 0. Blackpool 1, Barnsley 0. Cardiff City 0, Bristol City 0. Charlton Athletic 1, Wolverhampton Wanderers 3. Coventry City 0, Preston North End 0. Crystal Palace 2, Swansea City 0. Derby County and Sheffield United kick off shortly. Ipswich Town 2, Reading 0. Nottingham Forest 1, Burnley 2. Plymouth Argyle 1, Norwich City 2. Sheffield Wednesday 2, Watford 0. In the Coca-Cola League 1, Bristol Rovers 1, Walsall 3. Crewe Alexandra 2, Colchester United 0. Huddersfield Town 1, Tranmere Rovers 2. Leicester City 0, Millwall 1. Leyton Orient 0, Stockport County 3. Northampton Town 1, Peterborough United 1. Oldham Athletic 2, Milton Keynes Dons 0. Scunthorpe United 2, Carlisle United 1. Southend United 1, Hereford United 0. Swindon Town 1, Leeds United 3. Yeovil Town 1, Brighton and Hove Albion 1. League 2, Accrington Stanley 1, Notts County 1. Barnet 1, Morecambe 1. Bournemouth 0, Macclesfield Town 1. Bradford City 4, Exeter City 1. Bury 3, Lincoln City 1. Dagenham and Redbridge 3, Chesterfield 0. Darlington 2, Port Vale 1. Grimsby Town 1, Chester City 3. Luton Town 3, Aldershot Town 1. Latest score from Rotherham United 2, Rochdale 2. Shrewsbury Town 7, Gillingham 0. Wycombe Wanderers 0, Brentford 0. In the Blue Square Premier, Burton Albion 1, Weymouth 1. Cambridge United 0, Torquay United 1. Crawley Town 2, Mansfield Town 1. Eastbourne 1, Histon 1. Kettering 4, York City 2. Kidderminster Harriers 1, Oxford United 0. Northwich Victoria 0, Forest Green Rovers 0. Salisbury 3, Barrow 0. Stevenage Borough 3, Altrincham 0. Woking 3, Grays Athletic 1. And Wrexham 3, Ebbsfleet United 2. In the Clydesdale Bank Scottish Premier League, Aberdeen 1, Hamilton Academical 2. Falkirk 2, Hearts 1. Hibernian 2, Dundee United 1. Inverness Caledonian Thistle 1, St Mirren 2. Motherwell 2, Celtic 4. Rangers 2, Kilmarnock 1. Irnbury Scottish Division 1, Clyde 1, Partick Thistle 1. Dundee 0, Dunfermline Athletic 0. Greenock Morton 0, Queen of the South 0. Livingston 1, Airdrie United 2. And Ross County 1, St Johnstone 2. Scottish Div 2, Brechin City 3, Arbroath 1. Queen's Park 0, Peterhead 1. Raith Rovers 1, East Fife 1. Stirling Albion 3, Alloa Athletic 2. Stranraer 1, Ayr United 3. and Scottish Div 3. Albion Rovers 1, Dumbarton 3. Cowdenbeath 2, Berwick Rangers 1. East Stirlingshire 0, Stenhouse Muir 2. Elgin City 1, Annan Athletic 2. And Forfar Athletic 0, Montrose 1. In the Welsh Premier, Bangor City 0, Aberystwyth Town 0. Carsus 0, Neath 0. Carmarthen Town 2, Gap Connors Quay 0. Newy Cefn Druids 2, Newtown 3. Port Talbot Town 3, Prestatyn Town 1. And Rhyl 2, Haverford West County 0. The JJB Sports Premiership, Ballymena United 0, Glenavon 3. Cliftonville 2, Dungannon Swifts 2. Coleraine 3, Bangor 1. Linfield 1, Crusaders 0. Lisbon Distillery 5, Institute 2. Newry City 0, Glentoran 0.
One leg kickoff in Coca-Cola League 2. It's Rotherham United 2, Rochdale 2. Quick reminder for football fans of clubs that play lower down the pyramid system of English football. There'll be a rundown of all the Blue Square North and South results during our results roundup after 5:30. But let's move now to the updated Barclays Premier League table. Liverpool on top following their first win over Manchester United under Rafa Benitez. However, Chelsea could regain the lead by meeting Manchester City in the 5:30 kickoff. Arsenal are the third of the big four to occupy their usual lofty position. But Hull City are in uncharted territory. The promoted club are in a Champions League spot. Just 34 games for them to hold on now. Tottenham's players need to earn their Spurs in Monday's home game with Aston Villa. The North London club now bottom following a first win of the season for West Bromwich Albion. Everton and Stoke meet tomorrow, while the table will do little to improve the mood of Newcastle United supporters. In the Coca-Cola Championship, leaders Wolves recorded their fourth successive league win, coming from behind to beat Charlton by 3-1. They're ahead of Birmingham on goal difference. Alex McLeish's side climb a place following a 1-0 win over Doncaster. Preston remain unbeaten after a 0-0 draw at Coventry, but they slipped to third. Fourth place Bristol City also held to a goalless draw at Cardiff, both teams still unbeaten. Sheffield Wednesday, the big movers, into the top five after a 2-0 win over Watford, although rival Sheffield United could move above them when they play Derby later this evening. Derby County a bottom, a point behind Plymouth, who lost 2-1 at home to Norwich. Barnsley have slipped into the bottom three after losing 1-0 at Blackpool. Let's look at Coca-Cola League One. Unbeaten Oldham have extended their early season lead to 3 points. They enjoyed a sixth successive home league win, while Carlisle suffered a first defeat of the season at Scunthorpe. Away wins for Leeds and Millwall. Cheltenham are bottom and managerless following Keith Downing's departure this morning. Hereford's poor away form keeps them near the foot of the table, while Huddersfield slide 5 places today. Coca-Cola League Two. Stuart McCall's Bradford, the new leaders after a 4-1 win over Exeter City. Bury climbed to second. They beat Lincoln 3-1 to maintain their 100% home record. This morning's leaders, Wickham, were held to a goalless draw at home by Brentford and slipped to third. And what an afternoon for Shrewsbury Town. Paul Simpson's side thrashed Gillingham 7-0 and climb a place to fourth. Luton beat Aldershot 3-1 but remain bottom because of their huge 30-point deduction. Bournemouth, who also had a deduction, lost at home to Macclesfield. But Barnet, in 21st, picked up a first point of the season. They drew 1-1 at home to Morecambe. Blue Square Premier League. Crawley have crept into top spot after beating overnight leaders Mansfield. Salisbury level with the leaders on points, while a win for Kettering means they had 3 clubs on 17 points. Lewes and Northwich remain winless, but Woking are up a place after earning their first victory at the expense of Greys. Altrincham and Oxford both lost. In the Clydesdale Bank Scottish Premier League, Rangers have extended their lead to 3 points after coming from behind to beat Kilmarnock at Ibrox. Kilmarnock dropped to third behind Celtic, who won 4-2 at Motherwell in the lunchtime kickoff. First defeat of the season for Kilmarnock. They went into the game unbeaten. The other end, Falkirk off the bottom following a late winner against Hearts, their first points of the season. It's now Dundee United who prop up the rest. They lost 2-1 at Hibernian. The thoughts of Martin Keown, Lee Dixon and Garth Crooks on today's Barclays Premier League performances on the way after this summary of the seven games that have been played so far. Unbeaten Liverpool go top of the table. An own goal and a Ryan Babel winner beat Manchester United for the first time in nine league matches. Newcastle fans came to protest against the departure of their Messiah and then saw a King give victory to Hull. Marlon King's two goals provide the visitors with their first away win in the top flight. Gianfranco Zola wanted attacking football from West Ham. The new West Ham boss got it, but his new team lose to a late Chris Brunt goal at the Hawthorns. The focus was on Theo, but it's Adebayor's trio that grabs the headlines. The Togo forward proves he's still top gun at Arsenal. Top Gear has set Fulham on the road to a successive home victory. A superb solo goal from Bobby Zamora is the knockout blow to Bolton. Tale of two former Tottenham forwards at Fratton Park. Jermaine Defoe scores a second-half double to eclipse Mido, who had given Middlesbrough the lead. Amir Zaki's fifth goal of the season rescued a point for Wigan. Titus Bramble's own goal had put Sunderland ahead. The highlights of all those matches and the Manchester City-Chelsea game still to be played in tonight's Match of the Day. 10 to 11 start, all the goals, all the saves, all the major incidents will be shown. And it's a 10 o'clock start time for Match of the Day 2 tomorrow night at the Stoke-Everton game centre stage. So, Martin, Liverpool's victory against Manchester United, what does this say, if anything, about Liverpool's title credentials?
Well, it looks now that they're playing with that energy that you require to be champions. The whole of that atmosphere today was fantastic. Don't forget they went a goal down early on. They showed good character, came back into the game, and they'll be well pleased to finally beat Manchester United at home.
Yeah. Who was saying Liverpool had no chance to win this title this afternoon?
He was.
Lee Dixon, yeah?
Me? I just said I don't think they'll win the league. That's all I said. I didn't say they got no chance. They've got a chance.
What do you feel about Liverpool?
Changed his tune. What
do you feel about Liverpool's title credentials?
I think today showed, proved to me at least, that they've got the confidence. Having beat Manchester United, the champions, and European champions, by the way, it gives players confidence. It's that confidence that can take them through the next few games, and they can build on that.
A significant victory for Liverpool, but events at St James's Park are dominating everything. Pre-match protests, the management structure being ridiculed by the Newcastle fans who are so unhappy at Kevin Keegan's departure.
Newcastle are in disarray, make no mistake, complete disarray. Ashley wasn't there today, so that tells me he's not prepared to face the music. And I rather suspect that the people in Newcastle are prepared. I think if Ashley was prepared to face the music, I think the Newcastle people would respond to that. And I think the tackle by, I think it was Danny Guthrie, typified Newcastle's position at the moment. It's one of the worst bits of petulance I've seen in football for years.
The frustration boiling over, perhaps. Back to St James's Park now. The backdrop to the Newcastle Hull game was those protests from Newcastle fans by the resignation of manager Kevin Keegan. He really felt undermined by the management structure imposed on him by club owner Mike Ashley. Talks were held last night to try and see if there was a compromise that could lead to Keegan's return. Jonathan Pearce commentated on the game for Match of the Day. Let's hear his assessment of the situation as things stand.
16th, and I saw the balloons of optimism go up on the day that Kevin Keegan returned as manager. To be here today was an astonishing experience. Such deflation, such bitterness on the air, a fractious afternoon for Newcastle United fans. Protests outside the ground, inside the ground, placards about the removal of the board. The fans saying there's only one Kevin Keegan, Ashley out, a reference to the chairman, sack the board. Another banner referring to Newcastle's Cockney Mafia, Dennis Wise, director of football here. Those big figureheads did not sit in the director's box. Very, very clear signal sent out to the fans, those empty seats. The fans tried to get behind their side. But for the moment Nicky Butt slid in and brought down Hull Mercy to give away a penalty to Hull City in the first half, you just sensed that this was not going to be a day for Newcastle. The penalty stroked home just by Marlon King. Second half, Newcastle defence hopelessly drifting one side of the field of play, lopsided, away went King, seemed to let the chance go before putting Hull City 2-0 up. Newcastle's players looked like strangers, looked as if they didn't want to be here. More importantly, it looked like a rudderless ship. The fans' frustration grew and grew. They did get one back. Sisko on his debut, good for him. He had missed a couple of chances. And Michael Owen had a first-half header save, very well by Boaz Myhill. But Newcastle's performance was poor. And the sending off later on for a wild challenge by Guthrie spoke volumes about their current frustration in the dressing room. These are bad, dark and gloomy days for Newcastle United. And for their fans, I hope there's a brighter future.
I'm not sure this is healable, are you, for Mike Ashley and his directors?
I don't think, you know, the meeting he had with Keegan over the last 24 hours or so, was that a damage limitation as he tried to, you know, save face with the fans? It's not worked today. None of them were there. Keegan wasn't there. Ashley wasn't there today. The fans are showing what they think about it. He's got to face the music or he's got to walk. One or the two, he's got to help Newcastle do one or two things. And at the moment, nothing's going for him.
If Mike Ashley wants to sell the club, the price is going down at the moment because anyone that wants to buy knows he's in a bit of a mess. Will he have to really eat humble pie and get Kevin Keegan back?
Well, it looks like Kevin Keegan's winning at the moment. I mean, such a dour atmosphere. And these players are having to play in this. And that's what the end result is, that the players, you know, just go downhill. It's a terrible atmosphere to play in. There didn't seem to be any characters on the pitch today. And really, something needs to be done very quickly. Otherwise, the club's on the slide.
Cockney Mafia out was a banner that went round the ground to great applause at half-time. What are your thoughts on that, Garth?
Well, they've lost the leader in the dressing room, the manager. And no football team can survive without a manager. They've got to replace him very quickly. And they've lost the leader in the boardroom. Where is he? A company is in dire straits. Where's its owner? Where's its leader? And I rather suspect that if Ashley was to face the Newcastle fans and said, look, I have got a plan, I can heal this, I'm not running, which he looks at the moment, I think it is healable. But at the moment, he looks like a scared chicken.
West Bromwich Albion won their first Premier League game of the season with a 3-2 victory over West Ham. As the manager of the Baggies, Tony Mowbray, talking to Roger Johnson.
Tony, congratulations. A good first win of the season.
Yeah, you know, we needed it. It was a strange old game. It was a very open game of football. And as you would expect, two teams that try and play an open, expansive game. And, you know, we sit here 3-2 victors and it could have been, what, 6-all? I felt as if we could have been 3 up before they scored and yet they you know, hit us twice, some very poor defending from our part, and understandable, I suppose. We've had Jonas Olsen playing today, who didn't know half the team's name. They came back on Friday from international duty, and they'd all left when he signed on the last day. So it wasn't ideal preparation for us today, but delighted to get the points.
For a guy who didn't know his teammates, he had a rather good game.
He did okay. He's a big man. He's been playing in Dutch football, and he's not used to so many balls to have to try and deal with his head. He wants to get it off the goalie and play, and at times it's not right to do that. But he'll adapt. My original plan was not to stick him straight in the team, but injuries dictated today that we needed to do that, and I think he did okay.
And one of those players that came back, Chris Brunt, I mean, a lot of the international players obviously tired after midweek, but he had enough energy in his legs to race away at the end.
Yeah, he's, Brunt, he's a trying to find the right adjective. He's an enigma, I suppose. He's got as good a left foot as I've ever worked with, and yet he can frustrate at times. But you know, he scored some crucial goals for us last season. He scored the goal that's just about put us into this division, and a great goal today to get our first 3 points.
West Bromwich Albion, how did they perform overall, Martin?
Yeah, it was a cracking game, end to end stuff. But their problems being an end product and scoring goals, and they scored 3 today, so. Great win for them today.
What do you think Gianfranco Zola learns about his new team today? He officially takes charge on Monday.
Yeah, well, there was a good attacking play from him. Defensively, they were a bit poor, let 3 goals in, but there was some signs of them going forward. Know that about them. They've sold a couple of defenders, so he'll be worried about that side of the game. But normally, Gianfranco's teams attack anyway, so it'll be interesting to see what happens at the back in the next game.
Tony Mowbray's invested in good quality football. He's not always got the rewards for that, but I'm pleased for him today. He's got his rewards for playing good football, attacking football, and he got away with it just about.
Arsenal 4-0 winners away to Blackburn with England's hat-trick hero Theo Walcott influential in the victory. There's the Arsenal manager, Arsene Wenger.
Well, Arsene, with so many of your players away this week on international duty, different parts of the globe, I guess fatigue was always a worry for you. No suggestion of it today, though.
No, we've had a good game, combining well against the Blackburn side. It was always dangerous as well going forward, and we needed a good defensive performance, especially on crosses. But overall, I'm very pleased with our attitude.
And how pleasing is it to have the number of goals that you scored today, just to underline the superiority you enjoyed in all over the park?
Well, it's always good when you're clinically deficient, you know, because to be dominant without scoring is scary. But recently we scored 4 against Twente, 3 against Newcastle, 4 today. So that means we find slowly our way and with being efficient as well.
And a hat-trick for Emmanuel Adebayor, who up until today hadn't scored in the Premier League, so he's off and running. How important is that for you?
We have many players who can score, you, and therefore, one time it is Van Persie, and credit as well to Van Persie because he gave a penalty to Adebayor. You know, he's supposed to take it, and they share it with each other, and I find that very good for the team spirit.
We have to talk about the man of the moment, Theo Walcott, who some people thought you might leave on the bench today. You played him, and straight away, such an involvement in the first goal.
Yes, and I think he was on a high and didn't look too tired, you know, and therefore I decided to play him. But I believe he's more confident, made a very good pass on the first one. He nearly scored one, and maybe he should have given that ball, but that's part of the learning process as well. He's dangerous and he's confident, and when you're confident, you can grow at 19 years of age.
Martin, what was your assessment of Theo Walcott's performance?
Well, I'd have to say that's the best he's played in an Arsenal shirt. You know, he came off after 70 minutes, but, you know, his pace, his passing, his decision-making today was first class, and I think really Wenger's playing it down, but that's as boiled as I've seen him play, and you can really see he's brought that confidence back with him now from that England game in midweek.
I understand Adebayor's second goal is worth watching on tonight's Match of the Day.
Well, yeah, we were rewinding the tape at half-time to see where the move started, and we kept going back and back because they won it on the edge of the box with Danielson, and 30 passes later, Ray, it went from one side to the other, back to the left, to the right, to the left, and eventually it was Danielson knocked the ball in, headed it in, and we said that was probably the best passing goal we've seen, well, certainly this season, and perhaps for the next as well.
And that was the feature of the performance. Yeah. It was the passing and the movement of the Arsenal team. Admittedly, Blackburn never got close to Arsenal throughout the game.
No pressure on the ball,
was it? Didn't pressurise the ball, strung out like a line of washing, and Arsenal played through them.
Early days, but alarm bells for Birmingham yet? 4 points out of 12?
Birmingham.
For Blackburn.
I think this is Paul Ince's first real test. I thought they were rather unfortunate, regardless of the scoreline at West Ham, but today they were poor from start to finish.
Let's hear from Marlon King, who scored 2 goals for Hull City, taking his side to 4th place in the table. Victory at St James's Park this afternoon. He's talking to Jonathan Pearce.
Marlon, very well done. Beyond your wildest dreams today?
Not at all. Obviously, it was a disappointing result last week, but we knew we had to bounce back, and obviously all the stuff that was going on with Newcastle, we had a good opportunity to put things right, and we did.
Shea Given saved a penalty in their last home game against Kevin Nolan. Was that going through your mind?
The referee took a bit of time because I think there's a bit of fumbling at the edge of the box, but I made my mind up, put in the corners, and I thought he'd done enough to save it, but, you know, lucky for me, it went in.
And then could you believe how much space you had for the second goal?
Yeah, I did, and then I saw Nzogbia, I don't know where he'd come from, and I see him commit himself, so I thought going on my left side would take my strongest and just place it in the corner.
And although he didn't score today, Craig Fagan did a lot of work up front, especially for you.
Yeah, that's what he's all about. He's lively and he causes defences problems and drags defenders all over the place. And when you play up front with the two, it gives you a bit more of a breather and a bit more chance to get in the box.
Lee, you said before the game that Hull City, having lost 5-0 at home to Wigan last time out, will be determined to put things straight.
Yeah.
They deserve credit because it's going to get covered over by what's happening in Newcastle, isn't it?
I just think it's done Phil Brown a favour. In the dressing room before the game, you play Newcastle away. It's never easy to go up there and play. You got beat last week 5-0. And to his players, he's listening outside. He can hear murmurs of a protest. It's quite easy to get his players wired up for that game. And they did. And they went out. And it doesn't matter how Newcastle played away from home, to win 2-1 like that was a great result for him.
Fulham 2, Bolton 1 at Craven Cottage. Here's the Fulham manager, Roy Hodgson.
Well, Roy, in the first half particularly, that was almost perfection from Fulham, wasn't it?
I thought we played very well. I thought there was a very good spell in the second half as well. And strangely enough, the goal coming as it did, a bit of a slump, meant that the last 10 minutes were rather strange because, you know, for the 80 minutes in the game, we looked so much in control and had so many goal chances. And I think that Bolton will be happy they've got such a good goalkeeper. Otherwise, we might have aggravated the score. But you need to be able to win as well in the way we did. You need to be able to withstand that pressure because at this stage of the season in particular, a team that's not been very much involved in the game, who gets a lifeline with 10 minutes to play. They're always going to whack a few balls into your penalty box in the last 10 minutes, and you've got to have the ability and the pondus and the confidence to deal with it. And I'm happy to say we did today.
6 out of 9 for Fulham. News from St James's Park. Protests are continuing outside the stadium after Newcastle's defeat by Hull City, and also in the light of Kevin Keegan's resignation. Protests taking place outside St James's Park. Let's hear from the Sunderland manager, Roy Keane, talking to Alistair Mann after his team's 1-1 draw at Wigan.
Roy, does 1-1 about to summarise how this game went?
Possibly so. I think it might have been a fair result. Obviously, we have a great chance with Gibril going through one-on-one with the keeper when it's 1-0 to us. If we got the second goal, it's game over. But when you miss that chance, you know, obviously, we're going to put you under pressure the last 20, 25 minutes. And that's what they've done. And obviously, the lad for them took his goal well.
You had a formation today which had people like Elijah Duff doing a lot of work down the left-hand side in particular. It looked quite solid. It looked like it was really working for you today.
Well, it did work. Again, as I said, good players usually adapt to whatever role you give them. And as we tried it, and it worked a treat, particularly I think in the second half, in terms of being fairly solid. And then we opened them up with one or two occasions. And it's just a pity we couldn't get that second goal, which, you know, the move that we had for Gibril would have been more to a great goal to us. But as I said, the players all worked extremely hard. Juffy, Steed, the lads who've been in international duty. We had Anton making his debut, and George, who I thought have done very well, the two of them. So, you know, we know we have got to be a bit patient with these new players.
Yeah, more reaction to this afternoon's Barclays Premier League games now. A great win for Arsenal. Emmanuel Adebayor scored a hat-trick at Ewood Park. Here he is talking to Martin Fisher.
Well played, Emmanuel. First hat-trick of the season, first goals of the season.
Of course, it was important because a lot of people were asking me when am I going to score my first goal. So I think today I have shown good character. And I just keep telling them that anyway, the most important thing for me is the team to win. And I think today we have shown again a good character. We won the game 4-0, so it's good for the confidence.
And you had a little discussion with Robert Van Persie about who was going to take the penalty, is that right?
Yeah, of course, because I know he's very good in penalty. He knows I'm very good as well, so truly I just told him that, yes, because anyway, in between us, it's going to be him or me. So I just told him today I'm feeling very well to take the penalty, and he gave it to me. So I'm very pleased anyway, you know, as soon as you feel better to take the penalty, I took it and I put it in. So that's the most important thing.
Arsenal 4-0 winners. There's the scene at St James's Park. Newcastle fans airing their displeasure at the situation of their football club. Newcastle United fans unhappy with Mike Ashley and the management structure in the light of Kevin Keegan's resignation as manager. Just to say, for full details on all today's football news, for the results, the tables, goal scorers, match reports and post-match reaction, and for sports news across the board, you can go to the BBC Sport website, which is constantly being updated. And via the red button, we'll continue to hear from managers and players as they emerge from their dressing rooms. The league tables will cycle on the screen. Lee, Martin and Garth will continue to debate and discuss today's football results. Our football service continues till 6 o'clock. But this is where we say goodbye to BBC One viewers. Press the red button to stay with us in the final score studio. But otherwise, bye for now.